Hello and welcome to lecture 13. In this lesson, we'll talk about gradients and meshes. Gradients and meshes are two things that relate very much so to using Illustrator. Gradients are covered in depth in the textbook. There's a great exercise. I'll show you a little screenshot to jog your memory about that. Make sure that you do the reading, or you've already done the reading and it makes sense to you. If not, ask some questions, shout out, whatever it takes. Do some exercise files that go with the textbook or whatnot. But you definitely want to be familiar with gradients. It's a very useful tool in Illustrator, and you can't get by without it. Meshes, on the other hand, are not really discussed in the textbook at all. It's kind of a more advanced topic. Since at this point in the GIT program, there's not an advanced Illustrator class, I want to just hit on this really briefly so that you have a chance to understand that there's potential to take this a whole lot further. And that'll make more sense once we get into discussing what meshes are and how they work. First off, just a bit of review. A gradient fill, or just a gradient simplified, is a blend of two or more colors. You have a starting point and an ending point, and the transition area between those gives you a smooth blend from black to white or red to green or whatever it is, or you can add as many different colors in the middle as you want. There's probably a limit. I shouldn't say as many as you want, but you can put a whole lot of different color transitions along the way. There are different kinds of standard gradients: linear and radial, which if you've done the reading, you know what that is. If you've used Illustrator before, you know what that is. If you haven't, go give it a try. Just add a gradient and look in the options bar and change between linear and radial, and you'll see pretty apparently what the difference is between those two. Gradients can be saved as swatches. So think back to our last lesson about color swatches, and remember that gradients can be applied just the same way. Saved and transferred as a swatch that can be added to your Creative Cloud libraries and so on. And they can be applied to the fill or the stroke. So gradients are very dynamic. You can do a whole lot of stuff with it. This is a screenshot of the exercise file from the textbook. And if you followed along with that, you see there's a whole lot of things that you can do to really spice up an image with simple gradient techniques. This is, again, a very simple exercise file just to get you in the habit of trying out some of these tools. You can go a lot further, make much more dynamic artwork than just this with the gradient tool, or using the gradient tool to enhance other artwork. But anyways, that's beside the point. We're gonna move on from the gradient fill tool here and talk about gradient meshes. So a gradient mesh is very much more precise than a simple gradient, and it allows you to basically assign your gradient to specific areas on a grid. I'll show you what that means on the next slide. But by adding different colors to points on a grid, you can make very complex gradients, transitions between areas that allow you to kind of render shadows and highlights. That's the key to making things look three-dimensional or photorealistic. So here's a very simple example. You can easily do this yourself if you want to give it a try. Make a square or a circle or whatever you want. Go to the object menu and click on Create Gradient Mesh. And you'll see that you get this grid of points across your object. Now, this is where it gets a little more complex. You can add really simple just transitions by clicking on each one of those intersecting points on that mesh and choose a color from your color picker. So use the direct select tool, A on your keyboard, and click one of those points and then just choose a color. And you'll see that it's going to apply that as a blend from whatever that point is, the color that you assigned, to whatever the next point is around it. So I could make a radial gradient, a linear gradient, or any variation of transitions along this sphere with all those different points. And this is a simple using the Create Gradient Mesh tool, but you can get more complex than this by far. But that's a really fast way. This is not fantastic artwork, but that sphere on the right looks much more dimensional and has weight and has shadow and everything, as opposed to just a circle with a red fill in it, right? Okay, here's a better example of some more complex usage of gradient mesh. On the left-hand side, you see the wireframe. On the right-hand side, you see what the gradient mesh is applied. It's not a photo of a little car. You could be confused to think that's a 3D rendering, possibly. If you look closely, there's some details that obviously it's not a photograph, but it's pretty high quality art in terms of fidelity and colors and lighting and shadows. Now, that takes a lot of effort. This isn't an easy tool to use, but you can achieve pretty fantastic results. Here's another example. So this Iron Man poster, or concept art, I guess, for an Iron Man poster is pretty complex and looks like an illustration, something that somebody might illustrate. And I'm not talking about Illustrator, but somebody who can actually draw or paint. But it's done as a wireframe vector with gradient meshes applied to create all those subtle transitions between the different shapes and objects that make up those forms. Here's another example, pretty complex. Lots of detail in that vector wireframe over on the left-hand side. And you see as all those gradients start to fill in those various areas, you can replicate all kinds of organic shapes, fabrics, textures, things that are very difficult with just a flat fill or even a simple gradient. You can combine lots of different things, of course, patterns with gradients, gradient meshes with blends and all sorts of different effects. And that's the beauty of Illustrator or any design program for that matter, is that when you start combining techniques and tools, that's where you get real results. So lastly, this is a very short lecture. Hopefully you don't mind too much, but I just want to point out that gradient mesh is not a simple tool to master. You can quickly and easily give it a shot and make a simple sphere or something like that, like on the example that I showed you with that red circle. But to really be proficient at it and to do anything worth doing, it's going to take practice and patience and a whole lot of creativity. Some of the skills involved with creating a gradient mesh are the same things that an artist would need to paint something from scratch or to draw. You're creating and adding shadows using visual references, but you have to understand how that works, how light works, how shadows work, and things like that. Gradient mesh isn't going to magically make you an amazing artist. It's just an amazing tool for an artist to use. So go practice, give it a try. Don't spend a whole ton of that time on it this week. You've got plenty of other work to do coming up in the class. But as you go forward, and those of you that have maybe gotten your interest sparked in Illustrator a little bit by this class, that's a great next step, is to practice and try out and learn about the gradient mesh options that you have. Those of you that are already kind of proficient with Illustrator, this might be the way to polish off your skills a little bit and become a little bit more marketable by adding that to your toolkit.